Mary Pilon has worked as both a finance reporter for the Wall Street Journal and a sports journalist for the New York Times. In The Monopolists, she maps Monopoly's progression from quasi-socialist teaching tool to ultimately a game seeming to champion business practices antithetical to how the game began. And joining Pilon today is a fellow sports journalist and game enthusiast, Stefan Fatsis, has reported for the Wall Street Journal, for NPR's All Things Considered, and is one of the hosts of Slate's long-running sports podcast, Hang Up and Listen. And he's written multiple books, including Word Freak, A Look at Competitive Scrabble Playing. So please welcome them both. Thank you. Yeah, sorry.
You go first. You say thank you.
Hi. Thank you so much for having us. We're excited. It's not often that us board game sports beat reporters get to hang
out. The two of us.
especially during this weather, I feel like when he was like, you can shake hands, I feel like you can get a hug too if you want. I mean, I really appreciate that you're here.
Yeah, thank you for coming. Mary's book is terrific. I blurbed it. I've read it a couple times now. And I'm proud of it partly because our similar backgrounds. I mean, I did a board game book about 14 years ago now about the world of the subculture of competitive Scrabble playing. I became an expert Scrabble player. I'm no longer an expert Scrabble player, as a couple of people in this room can tell you. But these cultures are very, very similar, less with Monopoly on the playing side, but certainly in terms of the cultural history and the story of these games and their role in American society and in early and mid-20th century American life. And that's where the parallels are fascinating. Monopoly's story is a little darker, and we're going to get into that. Scrabble's, as I'll talk about a little bit when I grill Mary, is a little more wholesome. It was really an earnest, honest success story in America. Monopoly's is far more complicated. And Mary, let's just start with your protagonist, a woman named Lizzie Magie. She was a single, independent, self-sufficient woman at the turn of the century, very unusual in American life. And she had a really kind of crazy story for the times. Give us a little bit about her background first.
Sure. So she creates this game called the Landlord's Game. Can you hear me? Okay, great. So she creates this game called the Landlord's Game. And one of the questions I had in researching is I knew she had created this game. I knew about her patent. But I thought, how does a woman patent a game in 1904? And it turns out that her game was a teaching tool. It was called the Landlord's Game. And it was a protest against the monopolists of her time. Her father was this man named James Magie, who wasn't just politically active. He wasn't just a newspaper owner. He was an advisor to Abraham Lincoln and had traveled with him during the Stephen Douglas debates. So when I kind of started peeling back her genealogy and who her father was, the fact that he raised this daughter started to make more sense. And she was a feminist. She was outspoken. She actually lived here in D.C. for much of her life. She had appeared in theater. She wrote short stories. So it turns out that she was just kind of a Renaissance woman in addition to being a game designer, which was so unusual at the time.
Right. But she was also had this sort of weird political leanings. And I say weird now. It's only weird historically. She was a follower of this guy, Henry George, who was this single tax theorist. And you write in The Monopolist that this guy, Henry George, he wrote a book that was like the best-selling book of its time.
And he ran for mayor of New York City and came in second behind a Tammany Hall candidate. And the third place candidate was this Teddy Roosevelt guy. So in his day, he was a big, big deal. And actually, I was at an event in Cambridge, and Georgists were there. Like, there are still people.
What? They're still right,
and they were in the front row, and they had these, like, wonderfully detailed questions. And the Henry George Birthplace Museum in Philly, I went there for research. And so there still is kind of, but it's a little more academic now in terms of how people view it. I kind of think of George, without getting into, like, the really wonky description of how his theories work, as a reaction to the boom in wealth that happened at the turn of the century. So the Carnegies, Rockefellers, and so many groups kind of in this progressive tradition questioning how that should be distributed. So he's one of many of these different splintered, you know, thinkers of the time.
Right. But so Lizzie Magie is like an ardent follower of this guy. She like writes for anti-tax publications. She goes to conventions, and she decides to create a game. She's an inventor, which is also really rare for a woman at this time. So she creates this game, which is a tribute to the tax theories of Henry George. And most games at in this era had a message. So there was the Mansion of Happiness, right? The Checkered Game of Life. There was a game called Banking. Almost all board games post-Civil War through the middle part of the 20th century were very sort of grounded in some sort of message. And she wanted to do this game that was about tax theory.
Which seems weird now, but I had to kind of peel back, and I'm sure you did this in your book. If you look at the history of Milton Bradley and Parker Brothers, I mean, Milton Bradley was one of the early champions of the kindergarten movement in this country. And so the idea that games would be this teaching tool, and they were very moral. They were very, like the original Game of Life, I think there's an image of it in the book, had like a suicide square. Yeah. Like it's really dark. Yeah. And then think like, I also many times in researching this, like I think sometimes you romanticize the past, especially board games. You think, oh, you know, at the turn of the century, people playing in their parlors, playing by candlelight. And I had many moments when I would look at things and think, life was really hard back then. Like death just like pervaded culture in this way that nobody in this room, thankfully, you know, it's just so different. And so I, you know, the idea that she would use board games as a medium for expressing ideas, political or otherwise, is totally in line with the time period.
Right. And here's what she wrote. You quoted her. You found an issue of the Single Tax Review.
I read it every day.
Who doesn't
so
subscribe?
Yeah.
I think Politics and Prose actually has it on the stands. 1902, and she wrote, it is the game, she was talking about the game, it is a practical demonstration of the present system of land grabbing with all its usual outcomes and consequences. It might well have been called the Game of Life, as it contains all the elements of success and failure in the real world, and the object is the same as the human race in general seem to have, i.e. the accumulation of wealth. So, The monopoly, as we know it, is not an anti-tax, anti-capitalist, anti-accumulation game. It is a game about accumulation. How was Lizzie McGee's game played?
So she created two rule sets. She created a monopolist rule set and an anti-monopolist rule set. And the monopolist rule set is the one that takes off as a folk game. So when she creates her game, it starts spreading. It goes to Arden, Delaware, the single tax colony. And it's from there, and like Upton Sinclair was hanging out there. Scott Nearing, who was a very famous pioneer in the he had this big academic freedom case that got a lot of attention. So that's the rule set that takes off. One of the questions that has come up a lot this week is, why do I think that is? And I'm not sure if I know. I think it's a little bit telling about human nature that when given the option between like the virtuous academic version and the one where we clobber each other, that's the one that even these very left-wing people like chose. And I think it's because we get to do that in a way in this game that that we don't get to do in real life. So that's the one that takes off.
Right. And so Lizzie makes the game, and then she manages to get a patent on it.
Right.
And she manages also to sell it to a publishing company.
Right.
What happens?
So she creates this game called, she creates the Landlord's Game, and the Economic Game Company, which was a smaller group, publishes it. And what's unclear is how aware she was of the game's spread. It kind of forks off. And different groups, as they play it, add different modifications. So
it like goes viral.
Right. It goes viral, like 1904 style. So there's like a Philadelphia version of the game. There's a New York version of the game. And people are changing it. And she renews her patent. So it's not like she's not monitoring this. And it's a version of one of these kind of modified versions of the Landlord's Game that ends up being sold to Parker Brothers. So it's her game with some tweaks to it.
Right, but you're skipping ahead.
I'm skipping ahead.
You're skipping ahead. So it goes like to this place, to this Arden, which is like this weird utopian community in Delaware of all places.
And you can still go there, by the way.
Oh, really?
And you can still see, so Upton Sinclair's house there was called the Jungalow, and it was the site. And there may have been like a footnote in the book about this, I can't remember, but there was this like crazy sex scandal that took place then where somebody ran off with his wife.
Oh my God, that's like the title of the movie, the Jungalow.
And you can see, like, it's really funny because a lot of the houses that were built there are still there. And because of single tax theory and how it works is there were these little tiny cottages, and then people kind of added these little, like, they look like little caterpillars. It's very strange. And a lot of the people that went there were involved in some of the big grandiose buildings of Atlantic City. So there's this really interesting paradox where some of the people there that were making money and like flourishing on the business side in a town that was famous for its excess were living in this like little bohemian, you know, hippie utopia.
Right. So it goes to Arden, and then there are branches. The game starts getting played at Wharton, at Columbia, at Williams College. And then Atlantic City becomes like the sort of fulcrum because the critical changes. I mean, it could have been anywhere, I guess.
Right.
And this is sort of happenstance that Atlantic City happens. And why Atlantic City and Quakers in Atlantic City?
The
right?
Quakers. So the Quakers of Atlantic City embraced this game. And they were largely the group that was playing it were teachers. And so they were playing it with children. So they make it a little more simple. They put the Atlantic City properties on. And then this guy, Jesse Rayford, plays it and puts fixed properties on it. The original game, and actually earlier this week, I played played an earlier version of it where you auction every single property. And it's really disorienting if you're used to playing Monopoly, where every time you land, you have an auction and it changes the dynamics because you can just buy really early on. And so, but the silence is a tenet of the Quaker faith. So they decide we're going to get rid of the auctions and they put the fixed prices on, which I would argue is a fundamental change to the game. And so it's a version of that that this guy Charles Todd plays.
But what the interesting part of that version of the Atlantic City game is that they rename the properties.
Right, right. And they
make, and the properties sort of reflect Atlantic City's socioeconomic strata.
And Atlantic City at that time, if there are any Boardwalk Empire fans, you probably know some of this, that it was a melting pot. And, you know, Prohibition was a huge boom to Atlantic City because you could go there and get stuff you couldn't get otherwise. And people were coming in from Philadelphia and New York by train, and the properties on the board, you know, Baltic and Mediterranean, Atlantic City was deeply segregated. And they had segregated beaches and those were segregated neighborhoods. Boardwalk was, in fact, this marvelous marketing mecca. So as you kind of go around the board, and I don't even know how aware the Quakers were when they were doing this, but it was really funny to go through the depositions of this lawsuit, which I'm sure we'll get to later, and see how it matched with accounts of, you know, in newspapers then, census records, things. It seems like it actually was pretty close.
It couldn't have been unconscious to say that, okay, Baltic and Mediterranean are going to be the cheapest properties, and those just, oh, happen to be the African-American neighborhoods.
Right, and there's pieces where Quakers later talk about that and specific people that they knew, whether it was a maid or a housekeeper or somebody who worked at a deli or a friend who lived kind of in the middle class neighborhood. So they definitely, there were some, you know, decisions where they really wanted to bring people in the places they lived in onto the board.
Right, so they're playing in Atlantic City, and it's sort of an offshoot to get some people in suburban Philadelphia or in Philly proper start playing the game, and we get to our...
Dun, dun, dun. Plot point.
We get to a guy named Charles Darrow. And Darrow plays the game with some friends.
Yes, the Todds. People would have these Monopoly nights where you would come over and play. And so the Todds invite the Darrows over. They're old friends. They run into each other on the street to their home in Philadelphia. They play the game. They enjoy it. And then Darrow asks Charles Todd for a copy of the rules. And Todd thinks this is strange because imagine if somebody came over and played, like, I don't know, like, checkers or chess or something kind of common at your house, you'd think like, oh, well, that's strange. But he does it anyway. And then it's a version of the Darrow game. Darrow sells it on his own to Wanamaker's.
Darrow does this clandestinely. He's not working with his friend Todd, right?
No. Yeah. So, and the next thing that Todd sees is an advertisement for Darrow hailing him as the inventor of the game. And the Todds and the Darrows never speak again over this, according to what, you know, Charles Todd's account much later. So, and then the Monopoly story, Parker Brothers buys this game, and Darrow just kind of takes off as the inventor. His brand becomes integral to the publicity of the game. And at the time, you know, this is 1935, 36, so the idea that some guy went into his basement and created this is really, I think that story really resonated with people.
And I'm going to ask you to read now. I've opened to the page. From Charles Darrow, the president of Parker Brothers, Robert Barton, asked Charles Darrow to supply him for marketing purposes with a story about the invention of the game of Monopoly. And here's what Darrow wrote back to Barton.
I won't
Barton.
Read all of this.
Yeah, the relevant part. I love this part right there.
The history of Monopoly, dear Mr. Barton, the history of Monopoly is really quite simple. Friends visiting at our house in the later part of 1931 mentioned a lecture course they had heard of in which the professor gave his class script to invest and rated them on the results of their imaginary investments. I think the college referred to was Princeton University. Being unemployed at the time and badly needing anything to occupy my time, I made by hand a very crude game for the sole purpose of amusing myself. Later, friends called and we played this game, unnamed at the time. One of them asked me to make a copy for him, which I did, charging him for my time $4. Friends of his wanted copies and so forth. And then he goes on about, you know, getting in 1933, he should get a patent, and so much for the outline of the history of Monopoly. That's what his version is.
In other words, this was a complete and total fabrication. He made this up out of whole cloth.
Right. And by this point in the book, you know, you've walked through 30 years of the game's history. I mean, it's pretty indisputable. And even actually just this week, and I've written a few articles about it, and I get like stray people saying, oh, we have a board. Like even more of these boards are coming out even, you know, all this time later, which is astonishing. And this week, you know, I had a few more people. So the idea that this game didn't exist before 1935 is...
Well, and then the weird thing is that in my mind that the desire, the need to create this creation story is weird because it was already a great creation story. Right. I mean, Charles Darrow did have the idea that I could take this game that's been passed around and I could turn it into a commodity. I could turn it into a product and I could try to make money over it. It was clearly... in the public domain as far as he and all these other people that were playing it knew, but he makes this great step of deciding to make himself out to be the creator. And I mean, did you get any sense of why? I mean, is there anything
in the history?
Well,
Darrow's backstory turns out to be really interesting. And so other people had tried to sell Monopoly too. There were versions of the game financed. This guy, Dan Lehman, had sold it. A gentleman in Texas named Rudy Copeland had sold a game called Inflation. So there were other kind of similar games out and about. Darrow, you know, his backstory I wanted to know more about. And it turns out he actually was unemployed. And it turns out he actually was, you know, had hit upon hard times. He had two young boys, one of whom was intellectually disabled, which if you think about what that world would have been like in the early 1930s, your options were not great. So the money, like, actually did go to supporting his family. One of the things I think is important in this story to remember is that nobody knew they were sitting on Monopoly. Nobody knew they were sitting on a game that was going to be a hit, let alone one that we would be sitting here talking about all this time later. So a letter like that, you know, nobody knew how much money was at stake. I mean, people thought it was a good game, but I don't think that Darrow or anybody knew.
Right. In retrospect, it looks like a complete awful thing, like a totally awful thing to have done. At the time, it probably seemed innocuous to him.
Right.
It probably wasn't as evil as we might look at it.
Well, and one thing, too, that the Quakers of Atlantic City, who had played the game and taught Charles Todd and then later Charles Darrow, one of the things they say is, you know, when asked, why didn't you speak up? Why didn't you, you know, sue or do something? And they said, well, first of all, we're just not litigious people. That's not something we're interested in. But also, we didn't know who invented it either. So by the time the game is played in Atlantic City in the late 20s or 30s, Lizzie is already kind of removed from it in a way. And usually if somebody rips you off, you say, hey, that's not your idea. That's mine. But in this case, they knew they didn't invent it. So are they?
But Lizzie did find out. And in 1936, she does speak out.
Right. And she's not happy. So she does these interviews with the Washington Evening Star and the Washington Post. And there's a photo of her in the Evening Star where she's an elderly woman and she's kind of got this gray hair and this bun. And she's holding up her boards and says, like, I have a patent. Here are my boards. Like, here it all is. Darrow just kind of dressed this game up a bit.
Because at this point, Monopoly had taken off, right?
Yes.
Like,
it was
how crazy was it? Like, what were the sales figures for the
huge? They're in the book and we don't. So Hasbro, who owns Parker Brothers, doesn't break out detailed sales figures, but there's no disputing this game was a blockbuster in a way that no commercial board game had been, and especially in 1935, nothing was selling.
Until Scrabble in 1952.
Until Scrabble. But in the 30s, it was a big deal. And so this craze takes off and the Darrow story with it. And so she talks about this and she says that she got $500 and no royalties for creating this game. One of the last traces we have of her, she dies in 1948. She didn't have any children. Is the 1940 census. And she wore many hats. As I said, she had all these different careers and things, but she lists as her occupation maker of games and her income is zero. And the next thing we know is her obit. So, like, she just was clearly kind of faded away.
But at the same time, I mean, you know, maybe we can give Darrow a little bit of a pass. But at the same time, when Parker Brothers realizes that they are sitting on this gold mine or Monopoly takes off, they go after every other game. And they go after Lizzie Magie and they go after all of the inventors of Monopoly-like games.
Right. They go about acquiring these other games. Easy Money, they strike up this really bizarre licensing agreement with Milton Bradley, who at the time was their big rival. They acquire Finance, and part of that is they get this deal with Lizzie Magie to get her Landlord's game and two other games. And at first, she's really excited. She thinks,
she's flattered by
the
two other
games.
These
two other games, and, you know, Parker Brothers, this is such a great deal. But there's no evidence that these other two games had any, like, marketing push behind them or ever really had much steam.
All right, let's talk about how then you stitch together this narrative, because it doesn't become a story and it doesn't really become public until the 1970s when a college professor in San Francisco creates a game called Anti-Monopoly. And at this point, is it still Parker Brothers? It's still Parker Brothers
General
Mills had acquired Parker Brothers. But at this point, he creates this game and they get wind of it And this is why, this is like journalists get excited because people file lawsuits and there is an incredible historical record. So who is this guy, Ralph Ansbach, the college professor, and what happens?
Right. So Ralph Ansbach is a left-wing college professor. He's living in Berkeley, teaching at San Francisco State. He makes this game called Anti-Monopoly as kind of a protest against like the OPEC oil cartels. He wants to use it to teach his two young boys and his students about breaking, you know, how monopoly in real life, if you think about it, teaches us all these things that aren't exactly true. And he wants a more philosophically pleasing version of the game. So he makes this game, and it's not long before he hears from Parker Brothers attorneys who say, you know, you can't make this game. And it turns out that their attorneys were pretty aggressive. Later, we learn that they had sent letters to makers of games called Spaceopoly. There was a priest making a game called Theopoly who heard from Parker Brothers. So they were pretty aggressive about enforcing their copyright and trademark. So this kicks off this 10-year-long legal battle, and Ralph becomes obsessed with learning the history of the game, and he unearths the whole story dating back to Lizzie and has to fly around the country gathering depositions from people to prove his case. And this is in the 70s, and he's trying to find people who are around in the 20s and 30s, so some people are dead, some people are still around. And his case goes on for 10 years and kind of uproots his life and those around him.
But he does find these people.
He does find these people. He finds Dan Lehman. He finds Charles Todd, who's a big, big deal. He finds the Quakers in Atlantic City, who had put the relatives of the people who had put the prices on the board.
And he finds these boards.
And
right?
He finds these boards.
These people had saved them,
out
right?
Of their closets, and I mean, he little by little starts gathering all of this stuff.
And let's talk a little about the journalism part here. I mean, you were obviously aided and abetted by the lawsuit because these depositions exist. But you did, I mean, Ralph Ansbach is still alive, right? And so
yes.
How did you piece together this narrative reportorially?
I started with, the whole thing came about by accident. I was at the time reporting at the Wall Street Journal, and I was trying to use like a throwaway line about Monopoly being invented during the Great Depression. And I've always loved games and puzzles, but I thought, like, just like everybody, because that was the story that I and everybody else had heard, that would just be the easy part of a story. And I kept looking and looking, and it wasn't making any sense. And I came across Ralph and his lawsuit, and I reached out to him, and I said, hey, I know this sounds crazy, but I'm just a reporter at the Journal trying to find out the truth about Monopoly. And he was like, oh, I know all about Monopoly and the secret history of it. I'll tell you whatever you need to know. So I wrote the story, and then I wasn't done with it yet. I knew I had so many more questions. I think in the original story, Lizzie McGee's maybe a paragraph. So I didn't know anything about her. I didn't know anything about kind of what happened. So I flew out to San Francisco, and Ralph had like boxes of stuff. He had depositions, he had recordings, he had notes, he had photographs.
This is the part when the reporter's heart starts to
beat
faster. Yes,
because I think, like, especially if you're in a newsroom setting, you're so used to somebody, not used to, but like people will call you and say, like, I'm Deep Throat. And you're like, that's great. And you have to take everybody seriously, but often there's no there. And this was the opposite, where Ralph had not only told me a story, but as I started going through these documents, it was clear there were all sorts of things that either he had forgotten to tell me or just it slipped his mind.
Had he written a book that nobody read?
I mean, it wasn't a self-published memoir.
Right. Because it wasn't that this, with all due respect to your reporting, it was known that the Darrow story was bull.
And the court had accepted his version of his research. So actually that helped me because I thought, oh, it's not some conspiracy theory I'm putting out there. And people in the game world knew this. But the difference between people in the game world and collectors and everybody else, you know, that's like there's a lot of space there. So, and there were a lot of things.
There's a lot of space there, let me tell you.
So there, and there were things in the depositions that, I mean, Ralph was very focused on winning his case. So he was looking for one thing, and I was focused on the narrative. So a detail like, say, the Quakers and the purple properties, that was a throwaway line in a deposition. So that wouldn't have mattered in the lawsuit, but it mattered to me because I thought it was fascinating. So in Lizzie McGee, when I was trying to research her, I mean, Ralph proved that she was out there and knew kind of some broader things, but I wanted to know who she was because I basically wanted to write like a mini biography of her in some ways. So there were things that kind of shot off from those documents, but that was like the aha moment, I think.
Now the takeaway, if you're a board game geek like I am, and you've written a similar sort of narrative about the history
deep,
of a game. the thing that there are parallels here, and what's interesting to me is I was kind of pissed off when I know about the Darrow story, because my Scrabble guy, the inventor of Scrabble, is a guy named Alfred Butts.
It's very unfortunate.
And he was also out of work. It was also the Depression. And he also decided that I'm going to create a game to amuse myself and maybe give people a diversion and maybe make a little money. And in Butts' case, it was true. So Darrow, the liar, makes millions off of Monopoly and holds himself out as the inventor, but makes the game. He tries to sell it himself. He fails. And finally, after about a decade and a half, he finds a guy that says, I'll try to market it for you. And he's got a little more business savvy. He renames it Scrabble. He changes the design of the board, and it explodes. Now, Butts didn't end up like Lizzie McGee getting bought out for $500. He did get a royalty agreement, and he lived comfortably for the rest of his life. But at the root of these stories, there is this sense of sadness that the true innovators in culture get shafted.
Right. And so it's been very funny to see who, because you kind of become this like hermit when you're writing a book, and you do your reporting, and then but you have no idea who's going to read it and love it. And the group I've heard from most loudly are people in tech, which is so funny, because the idea of a bunch of like tech people being interested in board games is a little topsy-turvy to me. But it's the same idea of ownership of ideas. And if you talk to people in startups, they are so aggressive about, this person ripped me off, this person ripped my concept off. So and it happens in the video game industry a lot too. So it ended up like the core of that in both these stories is something that still is happening. Like,
I mean, and the Lizzie story is just so profoundly sad in a lot of ways that she had to watch this happen too. And you know, and how it's impossible, I think, to know just how conscious she was of how explosive and successful Monopoly was, but she clearly had an inkling, right?
Yeah, and the Evening Star story is like the big tip-off to that she was very aware that this craze was going on. I mean, you could look at it in a lot of different ways, right? So if her goal was to have her game played, boy, did she succeed, right? I mean, Monopoly is indisputably this huge game. She didn't see any money for it, and I doubt that many people who play Monopoly today say, oh, the single tax game, Henry George, that's so great. So I do think there's something sad to it. And I also think it's really strange how there are all these people, like to your point, that make things and make the world what it is. They kind of chip away. And I know with Edison and the light bulb, this comes up. I think I mentioned the Ferris wheel is another example. Like there are all sorts of inventions that we associate with people that sometimes they're like the better publicists. They don't necessarily have the guts of the idea. Right. And often the idea is a collaborative thing. It's not like you have a light bulb moment.
Right. Right. You didn't make that. Right. It's the Obama moment. the other parallel with a lot of these games, I think, is that just how important they became in culture. And I think it's, look, we still see this today when Candy Crush or whatever takes off on our phones. But the thing that struck me in researching Scrabble, and I can tell from reading The Monopolist too, is that you understand just how sort of central to popular culture these games became. I mean, Scrabble sold more than 4 million units in 1952, which was more than Monopoly ever sold in 1 year. And Monopoly was well over a million, I think 2 million in its early days. How did you sort of appreciate the way culture sort of grabbed these products and sort of ran with them, like how big they became?
It's strange because you read the stories. One of the things I spent a lot of time doing was reading newspaper clippings of when the Monopoly craze really exploded. And there starts to develop this pattern that I think still happens today, which is when you ask people about Monopoly or they start talking to you about it, seldom does it have to do with the play. It has to do with the memories associated with it. Like, I think Scrabble has this too. Like, it's so wrapped up in nostalgia for people. And and game designers love to trash Monopoly because they think, oh, right, it's a flawed game and here's why. And I think those points are all valid. But for most people who play it, it's a weird game because it's not actually about the game for people. It's about the holidays. It's about, you know,
right, it's about hiding. Yeah, it's like hiding money under the board.
Right,
for
right.
Game,
so it's, know? Yeah, exactly. And so everybody has these like really amazing stories of what they've learned about their friends and family playing it, which I can't. And so it's so funny because when you ask people about the rules, like most people don't play Monopoly right, which is something I think I flick out in the book. So nobody reads the rules for Monopoly. It's like so multi-generational now that it's, and so when I think it'll be around for a long time because of that, because it just keeps getting handed, you know, handed from one generation to another.
And what happens with these games too, and Scrabble and Monopoly both share this, is that when they finally pass into sort of big toy and become these annuities for these giant toy companies, the culture around them does change. And the way the companies protect these games changes. And I think it does change our impression and the culture of these games. I mean, they start in someone's living room, you know, manufacturing, you know, Scrabble racks out of balsa wood, or making these beautiful linen Monopoly boards with ink drawn in for each square, and they transform into something else. And you know, the Ansbach lawsuit, I mean, tell us about the 1970s, the Parker brothers went after these Cornell students who had what?
Right. So this is, so there's a
how-to book.
So these two Cornell students make this game called How to Win at Monopoly, and they get involved in this legal tussle with Parker Brothers because of, you know, them not having Parker Brothers' blessing to sell this book. One of them is ousted from a Monopoly tournament, even though he's really, really good. They and Ralph at one point join forces to sabotage this Monopoly tournament and tell, like, have a truth about Monopoly lecture. And what happens with these two Cornell students is one ends up becoming Jay Walker, the billionaire founder of Priceline.com. And the other is this guy, Jeff Lehman, who ends up becoming the president of Cornell University. And before that, clerked for Justice Stevens when the anti-monopoly case had approached the Supreme Court and had to recuse himself. And on, I guess it was Tuesday or Wednesday, I was at NYU Game Center, and Jeff Lehman was there.
No way.
So when I did this like spiel, you know, about the history of the game, and I told the story, and I was like, and that guy in the back. So it was so exciting to have like a character from the book there. So, so yeah, so there are so many nutty characters involved in all the different aspects of this. But their book is actually, if you're looking for like a pure how to play game, like a great read. It's out of print, but you know, you can find it online or kind of through the grapevine.
But the way that the companies protect these games is, you know, it is pretty iron-fisted.
Right. And that's something that they had a huge tradition of. So one of the pieces in Ralph's case he finds is when Parker Brothers went after this guy who made a game called Inflation in 1935 or 6. So they started doing this right away, and it just continues. And it's not unique to board games. I think there are a lot of brands.
No, it's protecting trademarks and copyrights too.
Because then if there's a tussle, I think one of the things that courts look at is, did you protect it? Like, did you make an effort to enforce it?
Right, but ultimately then it becomes, you know, it's the great irony of these games and their creation stories is that what starts out as a game about busting trusts ends up being the trust.
One of the things people have asked me, can you still buy anti-monopoly? And the answer is yes, you still can. And one of the places you can buy it is on Amazon. And I just find it like so deliciously ironic that you can buy, it might even be on Amazon Prime. I'm like, that's so funny. Like, I don't even know, like, I've never even actually asked Ralph about that. Like, how did that happen? Like, how did that, like, it seems so ironic anyway.
Does Hasbro, which is now the owner of Monopoly and Scrabble, does Hasbro still propagate the bogus Darrow creation story, or has the record been finally corrected? So, and did they cooperate with you?
They did not provide anybody available for interviews. I mean, but most of my book takes place before 1991, sure, when they acquired the company. So, and it's very coy, and I'm sure you've encountered this too. So now, like, the timeline just starts at 1935. And like, they're doing this 80th anniversary thing, which, I mean, technically it's not the 80th anniversary, right? And they say it's the Monopoly brand. And so like, I haven't seen like a Lizzie McGee mention on their website. I may have missed it. But it's strange. And I find it so strange because like, because they acquired the company so late. And I think the true story is really interesting. And from a marketing perspective, it's also really interesting, but you know, it is what it is.
Yeah. All right, I want to ask a little bit before we go. I'm going to do a little lightning round.
Oh.
But before we do that, I'm curious about, and I think people might be curious about, is the history of the tokens.
Yes.
Like, why are the tokens the tokens?
So in the folk game,
and I expect a full biographical description of each token. From
so
the
in the
game.
Folk game, people use buttons, earrings, clips, like whatever was around. And then when Parker Brothers starts making the game, supposedly it was just such a blockbuster that they just needed somebody to make these things. So they call on Manufacturing, which is this company in Chicago that was making Cracker Jack tokens. And you can see some of the early ones have like a little loop because they were often used as charms. So the iron, for example, I've been told that they would, if you were the iron company of Chicago or whatever, and you would give out these little tchotchkes, they would make these little irons. So the first batch were just like random schmandom things. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, they've changed kind of what they were through history, but they were an accident.
See, I always imagined that there was some sort of sociological reason right. behind them, like the iron represented, you know, the seamstresses, and the shoe represented, you know, the cobbler and the working person.
Yeah, I mean, in some level, right, if they do reflect the time period, because Doust was making these and they reflected like cast iron molds they already had. Uh-huh. So kind of, but I don't think it was like...
It wasn't like deliberate on the part of Lizzie right. McGee or right. anyone. Yeah. To sort of do this, to sort of further the notion of we hate big business.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Not that I'm aware of.
You like the thimble? Why?
So I like the thimble, and now I'm switching to the iron because they voted off the iron. Yeah. So I feel like I need to kind of like stick with it, you know?
Pluto is yeah. Yes.
It's the
iron
Pluto
is the Pluto
of
Monopoly. Of
Monopoly. Thank you.
Very good.
Right. So I do like the thimble. And I also seems to the Doust point, it seems so 1930s. Like, when's the last time anybody's ever referenced a thimble? Like, the idea of people sewing is just so antiquated in this way, I find charming.
Okay. Anyway. All right, I'll buy it. All right. Chance or community chest?
Just in general?
Just in general.
I feel like
chance.
Community...
I'm totally chance. But
oh,
ahead.
Really? I like community chest, I think. It's brighter, and also the story behind community chests is more interesting to me.
There's like a right. World War I story, right?
Well, community chests were these kind of, I don't even know, they might not even be like nonprofits technically, but people would donate and then you would redistribute the funds. And every community had one, and some of them became the United Way, which we all are familiar with. So,
see, I didn't know that.
Warm right, and fuzzy.
Your favorite colors on the board?
The oranges.
The oranges? I like the green.
That strip between jail and free parking is kind of yeah. where it's at.
And are you a free parking purist or
yes.
a put
no.
as much money in
no,
free parking?
No, absolutely. Because that's what makes the game go on so long. So if you actually play by the rules, which is free parking is just a place to hang out or free park.
So you're a Monopoly prescriptivist.
Yeah, I'm actually like a terrible person to play Monopoly with, I think. You're probably like a terrible person to play Scrabble with because like you're very focused. Like, you know,
yeah.
I don't know.
Right. Yeah.
Sorry. What a great pitch
terrible.
That was.
We're yeah. terrible at the games that we don't play, the
but
games
really
that we've written
people.
Books about.
With us, yeah.
Thank you. I'm out of questions. I think we can.
Thank you.
Open
are
it up
there
to some of your questions
from the masses?
There is a Yiddish language version of Monopoly that's called Handel Ehrlich. It's put out in New York State around Monroe, I believe. And the point of the game is to teach children how to give charity.
Wow.
But the place names are like Muncie or Williamsburg and stuff like that.
And is it a total...
Does
it look like Monopoly?
Yes, very much so. Yeah, so I just thought I'd let you know. I don't know
Thank
if you've
you.
Come across it.
I also learned recently of a Brazilian version of the game. And there was some... issue with like Hasbro and licensing it, so now there's identical games but they have different, like one's Rio and Sao Paulo. Anyway, so I love hearing about these.
I mean, are there still sort of samizdat Monopoly games out there? I mean, are there still illegal games? I mean, I'm sure Hasbro right. doesn't license the Yiddish Monopoly.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it happens. Like, a lot of the Opoly games are made through USAopoly, which has a license from Hasbro, but a lot of them are rogue. I mean, it's just like it's anything that big, you're gonna have like bootleg versions of it, I think.
So I know you both have a Wall Street Journal connection. I'm wondering if you know each other from there at all?
No, we didn't overlap. I left before Mary started working at the paper. And I covered sports at the Journal. And then Mary...
And I wrote about finance. So.
And then I wrote about finance before I went to the Journal.
Yeah.
And then Mary wrote about sports after she left the Journal. So we have these really overlapping.
But my book did start as a Journal article, but yours didn't? Or
mine
did
not. No,
right.
in their infinite wisdom, the editors of page one of the Wall Street Journal decided that my proposal for a story about Scrabble, about actually Thai players playing Scrabble, was not worthy of page one. So I said, oh, screw you, I'm going to go do it myself.
Yeah.
So I went and wrote a book about it.
That's so funny.
So I have two unrelated questions. Number one, have you heard anything in the last week or two of like crazy internal Hasbro memos of like people freaking out about, oh God, everyone's really going to find out now? And then part two, if you could just talk a little bit about the just like your writing process from like the day you decided I'm going to make a book about this and sort of like how, like how you divided your time between your day job and writing the book and how you sort of allocated this immense workload.
So part one, no. Not that I'm aware of. It doesn't mean it's not happening, but I haven't gotten like that dark phone call from a blocked number or anything. Maybe it's happening. I also feel like, I mean, Hasbro's such a big company now and they have so many things going on that I'm just like this like little like peanut, you know, kind of hanging out over here with my book. The time management piece, I was not a journalist who, and I don't know what your thoughts on this were, was like, I have to do a book. I was really happy writing articles at the Journal and then later at the Times and now freelancing. Like, I've always liked kind of the day-to-day instant gratification of being in like a more high news environment, fast news environment. And so when I wrote the story at the Journal, it was the first time I was like, I need to know more. And I kept reporting. And I think that it just became this thing I became obsessed with. So I think it was Doris Kearns Goodwin, who was on NPR recently. She was talking about, I'm paraphrasing wildly here, but like why she wouldn't do a book about Hitler or Stalin. She was like, these are people you have to wake up with. You have to wake up with them at odd hours. You have to have nightmares about them. You have to this and that. And I was like, yeah, so I've been waking up with Monopoly. So the fact that it was pretty different, one running coach that I was interviewing for a story, when he asked me about it when I was still working on it, he was like, oh, so your job at the paper is the sprint and the book is the marathon. And I was like, actually, that's like a pretty good way of thinking about it, because when you run a marathon, you feel like it's never going to end, but you know it will. And like there's ups and downs and, you know. So I didn't take any book leave, but it also did take me 5 years. So I don't know if the Mary Pilon way of writing a book is one I would recommend.
And I was the opposite. I wanted to write a book. It was my second book and I needed to get out of the paper, and I took 18 months off from the Journal and
so
wrote
amazing.
It. And it was a different sort of immersion, because I became a Scrabble player. So I became obsessed with the game itself. And my book is first person about me entering this bizarre subculture.
And the reporting trips were the hard part to schedule. Like, I used vacation days for those, but a lot of it was slogging through documents. And I was very fortunate because I live in New York City, so the New York Public Library had a lot of things. The Forbes Gallery had a lot of boards, which they've actually since auctioned off. So I tried to...
Auctioned off?
Yes.
Really?
And the Todd board, which I have photos of because it was in Ralph's case, we don't know who purchased it. So there's like this little group of people that are like...
Seriously?
Yeah, and the Strong Museum...
Did you bid on any?
With my piles of Monopoly
with your
money,
piles
right?
of Monopoly
yeah.
money?
All that money from...
Just,
you know,
like slide it over here.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's $100,000.
And by the way, every bad pun about Monopoly I've heard, like, trust me. And I told my editor, I was like, this will be a pun-free book. Like, nobody's going to jail. Nobody's passing go. Like, in the actual text of the book, like, if I'm signing them, I might do something like that's funny. But, like, I've heard every bad Monopoly joke. And I always laugh like it's the first time. But, like, oh, you got Monopoly money for your book advance. You know, ha ha. You know, like, all of it I've heard. But it's all in good fun.
So I learned about competitive Scrabble from reading Stefan's book and then was completely sucked into a world that I'd never seen before. And I'm interested in hearing more about, I didn't know that there was a competitive Monopoly scene. And so I'm interested in hearing more about that and whether have you played in a tournament? Have you met any of the players? Does it have a similar obsessive subculture like Scrabble?
Not like Scrabble. I mean, feel free to weigh in here. It's not like Scrabble. It's not, first of all, it's not as rigorous. Like, it's just not... And the Scrabble organization is
not as
separate.
Intellectual, let's be clear.
Yeah, and the Monopoly tournaments are kind of like whenever Hasbro feels like doing it. So, like, there was one in 2009 when I wrote my original story. So I did interview players for that. But even those people were people that played other games and happened to be really good at Monopoly too or interested in it. And there's one coming up, I think, this year in Macau. But it's not like there's like a regular, you know, season or like the Olympics, which are every 4 years. So therefore the culture of it's a little more splintered. And you can't really, I mean, to the game design point of why Monopoly is like flawed, you can't really like study up for Monopoly the way you can with Scrabble. Like, I think the actual, like what it takes to be really great at it, it's not as dynamic, I think, to prepare for.
Well, and I think it's also, like you said earlier, it's not viewed as a particularly sophisticated board game. And I think most board game enthusiasts are into the sort of the German designed.
Right, right. And I also think that like that criticism, which I think is totally fair, it's like the game, like it's like criticizing a Model T for being a crummy car. Like it existed for what it is. Like it's a different, I think it serves a different function as a game, but.
Well, I think its origin story is different too. I mean, my guy Alfred Butz was really trying to create the chess for words. I mean, he really saw the creation of Scrabble as an intellectual game that combined all the elements of other games. There was luck, there was skill, it involved language, there were no games that were similar. I mean, Monopoly evolved because of a very different sort of set of desires among its players.
Right, for sure. And the other thing with Monopoly is that I find playing it, and I do love to play it, that like the deal making to me is the fun part. And so if you're playing with like a stubborn family member who just like doesn't want to do deals, like the game kind of dies. Like it's just, it becomes very lopsided if the players aren't of an equal skill or aggression level. But that's just
clearly aggression level. Yeah. Would be the key component.
Stefan, you mentioned Candy Crush is sort of the modern runaway hit game equivalent, which is sort of mortifying that something so brainless could be that big a hit now. I'm just wondering if either of you, because you both come working about games ahead, ideas behind them, if anything intellectual in the future could ever sort of, or ideological, could ever become a runaway hit again.
Sure.
Or do you think this moment in culture has passed?
Well, I want to know what you think of Settlers of Catan, because I think I love that game, and I think there's a lot going on there, and I think you can play it. So I think that these games, yes, I do think there are, and I think that like Kickstarter, like if you're a game designer, I think it's actually a really good time to be in business, because there aren't the gatekeepers. It's very analogous to publishing, right? I mean, so if you have a great idea for a game, whether that's as a teaching tool or this or that, you can make it and somebody around the world can buy it online. So I do think that the infrastructure is there to make that happen.
I don't think it's as dependent, right, on the system that Lizzie McGee or Charles Darrow or Alfred Butts went through, I mean, was very rigid. Right. I mean, it was write a letter to these seven games manufacturers or book publishers very often and get rejected usually. Parker Brothers was, I mean, for Darrow, I mean, Parker Brothers was really ramping up at the time that he approached them with Monopoly. So it was a much more limited business model. And I think today, I think intellectual games are thriving today. Not to stick with Scrabble, but Words with Friends is an intellectual game. I mean, it's an inferior strategically to Scrabble. And I don't just say that because I'm completely biased, but it really is inferior strategically. And it's a total ripoff. It's just a modification of Scrabble. But, you know, millions of people play this. And regardless of at what level they play it, they're playing an intellectual game. So I think, there's absolutely opportunity in the world.
Right. Any last questions before we wrap up?
Patents are typically 17 years. Is copyright and trademark the same or
Oh,
different?
God, I'm so not a lawyer.
Okay, I was just wondering.
It's in the book. One of the things, the reason I'm also hesitant to answer that is whenever copyright or trademark law comes before Congress, there's always like a group of people who lobby to change it pretty aggressively. So like the Disneys, the Gershwins, so it's this morphing, constantly changing thing. And even after it was rewritten after Ralph's lawsuit in the 80s, it's changed so many times that in the book I kind of froze it in the mid 80s because I just want to show the impact the lawsuit had, because it's still changes so often.
Yeah, but copyright, trademark, right, and patent, and I'm not a lawyer either,
right,
are very different. I mean, Hasbro with Scrabble still has protection on trademarks on Scrabble, but they're about the design of the stars on the board, the design of the squares. It's not the playing of the game that's protectable. It's the design of the game that tends to be protectable.
And there are actually, I interviewed a lot of lawyers in this field who focus just on games, because in some of these lawsuits, it does come down to what, you know, elements look like, how it's played. I mean, it gets very, very, very detailed.
Just one other thing. I had sat down with some kids to play it a while back, and I was appalled. It was like credit card. There was no cash.
Yeah.
And I was like, don't you think the cash is better?
I did a Sunday review piece for the Times about that and just how ironic that was, especially given the like game's history. And I think that there was even a version where they had properties that were like real companies, so like McDonald's and Walmart, and
this is a common and, to I think purists, a very disturbing trend with the big game companies, is that they're desperate to, you know, they see what's going on digitally, they understand that people aren't necessarily buying a board game and pulling it out of the closet, and they've got to find ways to sort of tart up these games. They've found some success with, you know, Mary mentioned how they did Hasbro did an online vote, you know, they knocked out the iron and they added a cat or something.
Yeah.
It was a cat. Scrabble did the same thing, where there was a vote last year to add a word to the dictionary, to the Scrabble dictionary. So, and a lot of the changes have been to add like electronic features to the board games, or change from cash to credit cards, anything to create a modified version of the classic. The sad thing is that the classic is pretty good because it's classic.
Okay, I'll be fast. This actually might be too hard to answer, but maybe at least in your two particular cases. I'm interested in how the games, which games suddenly take off. So both of these were kind of around for a while, and then suddenly they were selling millions. So was it the right time and place, or is it about the marketing? And, you know, is that true today?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that what makes the toy and game industry in particular so hard for people is that you can't predict that. And there are all sorts of stories. These all kind of hit the cutting room floor. And it happens in video games, too, where people thought this was going to be the next big thing. And people go to Toy Fair and they show off this thing. And then they put it out on the shelves and nobody wants it. And then you have something like Nerf, which just, like, you know, takes off. So what that calculus is interesting. And it changed a lot for board games, too, because it used to be you had to advertise to people's parents. And then when TV comes around, you can advertise directly to kids. So you have a bunch of, like, typically adults trying to figure out the minds of children or the minds of a mom who's shopping or this or that. So I think it's like any consumer good. It's really hard to say. I mean, a lot of people think like, oh, the thinking before Monopoly was nobody wants a financial themed game. It's too wonky. It's too complicated. It's too boring. Why do people want to talk about real estate and money when nobody has any of that? But there's also a school of thought that think that's exactly what made it really take off in the 30s.
Well, and I think there are cultural moments that do influence why these games take off. I mean, I think Scrabble took off largely. It was post-war. The idea of leisure time was huge. The media was changing. There was television. Newspapers and magazines were getting fatter and thicker, and there was more advertising and more editorial content. The idea of something going viral, I think, really changed after the war. And people wanted, you know, there was a real sort of cultural consciousness of the idea of, hey, let's find something that we can all do to pass the time. And, you know, I don't think it's any different. I think it's some weird thing that goes on in our brains that says, oh, this is desirable. This is something I want to do over and over and over again. And those are the ones that end up becoming these lasting products in our culture. I don't think Candy Crush is going to be a lasting product in our culture the way that Monopoly or Scrabble or other games are.
Hey, sorry, coming for a question again. But I did play a copy of Monopoly that I think had been relatively recently produced, like sometime in the last 5 to 10 years, in which I noticed the Baltic and Mediterranean were brown instead of purple.
Yes. So that's controversial. some of the newer sets so there's a company called Winning Moves that releases a lot of the old kind of Hasbro or whole like Parker Brothers, Milton Bradley games under a license. So some depending on who you ask, that's either a return to how the game was originally published or the British version of the game that Waddington's had the license for. So the claim is that it's a return to the old thing. But I mean, the purple one was around for so long that it just seems like...
Well, that was one of the features of the Darrow board. I mean, Darrow had a friend who was a graphic artist, right?
Right.
I mean, the reason the Monopoly board is so beautiful, and I think that has something to do with why Monopoly was so successful too. I mean, aesthetically, the Monopoly board is great. The fonts are lovely. The colors are bold. I mean, it's a really beautiful,
cool looking,
it's very art.
Sure.
It's very cool looking.
Right. So yeah, so that's, I'm not a fan of the brown properties, but to each their own. Right.
Well, because I think it was a while ago that Atlantic City changed all their street signs to match the Monopoly board, right? Oh. So they actually have the purple signs, not the brown signs on Baltic and Mediterranean, I believe.
Nothing sacred anymore. I'm not surprised.
All right. Well, we are about out of time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.